Good evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. We go one-on-one with Donald Trump. Now, by now, you know the billionaire businessman turned reality TV star is a presidential candidate unlike any we have seen. Since entering the race, he's dominated the field, defining the discussion and forcing all other GOP candidates to take him seriously. A recent CNN ORC poll found him second only to Jeb Bush when it comes to Republicans' choice for president. 19% for Bush, 12% for Trump, with the rest of the GOP field in single digits. Now, over the next hour, you're going to hear what Trump has to say about his opponents, why he wants to, in his words, bomb the hell out of the oil fields of Iraq, and why he's not backing down on his controversial comments about illegal immigrants. Now, unlike a lot of politicians, Trump arrived for this interview today not surrounded by advisors, but pretty much on his own. And nothing was off limits. I started off asking him about Hillary Clinton. First of all, Hillary Clinton gave her first interview yesterday in a long, long time, first national interview. She gave it to CNN. You give interviews all the time. You're out there. You're talking extemporaneously. Why do you think Hillary Clinton is not talking?
Well, Anderson, she's got a lot to hide. She gets a subpoena on emails, and she, I mean, from the United States Congress, and she gets rid of the emails and her server and everything.
She
gone.
Said yesterday in the interview, by the way, she didn't get a subpoena. There isn't a subpoena.
I mean, they said they issued a subpoena, but you're right. I mean, she handled it like, you know, what's going on? How can you do that? She has a lot to hide. She doesn't want to talk to the press. Look, she was the worst Secretary of State in the history of the United States.
But you used to donate, I mean, you gave a lot of money
sure.
to her over the years.
Because I was a businessman, I guess I still am, but I was a businessman, I was with everybody. Everybody loved me. When I called them, they always treated me well. And that's part of the game. And that's part of what's wrong with this country. Because as a businessman, I could have gotten anything from anybody. And that is part of the problem. Lobbyists, donors,
well,
special interests.
Is that why you were donating the money to the people you donated? Because you donated to Democrats. I think in 2006,
sure.
you gave $20,000 to the Democratic Congressional Campaign Fund. You gave
$1,000. Democrats and Republicans.
You
I get
gave
along with everybody.
To Republicans.
Oh, whatever. I've given millions.
Now,
I've given millions to everybody.
So do you give, though, based on principles, or do you give based on who's going to do things for you politically?
They all love me. Let's put it that way. They all love me. I'm a very, very, I did very nicely in life. And frankly, you give, and it's part of the problem. And I talk about it all the time. Part of the problem.
So even though you're doing it, you say it's a problem.
Well, I'm saying this. They won't necessarily do what's right for the country. They'll do what's right for their special interest, their donor, their lobbyist, et cetera. Not good for the country.
But you know, when you're going to get on the stage during those debates, and your Republican challengers are going to say, look, you're all over the place politically. You say you're a conservative Republican. You're giving money to Hillary Clinton, Harry Reid, Nancy Pelosi.
I get along with everybody. And that's part of the problem we have in the country
also.
So you
were giving money based on political beliefs. You were giving money based on currying favor, like many people do.
People love me. And you know what? I've been very successful. Everybody loves me.
Politically, the other thing they're going to say is you're a flip-flopper politically. You say now you're a conservative Republican. Smoking gun goes back to 87 with your registration record. You were Republican, then you were independent, then you were Democrat for 8 years, then you were unaffiliated, then you were Republican. Then
you have to look at what Ronald Reagan did.
He switched around, too.
Not so much different.
Well, to somebody who says, though, look, you're the guy who said you're the stand-up guy, you're a decision-maker, you seem to kind of be indecisive politically.
You do have to understand that I'm in New York City. It's virtually impossible in New York State. If you look, I think it's 3-1 Democrat to Republican. It's virtually impossible. So as a businessman in New York City, and now all over the world, but as a businessman in New York City, I have to get along with Democrats. If I don't get along with Democrats, I'm sort of like out of business.
But were you a Democrat when you said you were a Democrat?
I was a Democrat for a period of time early on, and then I was also an independent, and then I became a Republican.
I got to ask you about a couple things in the news. Washington Post, as you know, say that some of the workers building this beautiful hotel that you're building down in Washington, D.C., are illegal. They talked to 15 workers. They said a number of those 15 came here legally through asylum. They're now legal, but that a number of them did say they're illegal. Isn't it hypocritical for you saying that illegal immigration is killing this country to be employing illegal immigrants?
I read the story, and by the way, that story does not name any names. I'd love them if they could give us the names, but they said they spoke to one or two But they don't name them, and they don't even know if it's true.
What they say is several of the men who hail mostly from El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala have earned U.S. citizenship or legal status through immigration programs targeting Central Americans fleeing civil wars or natural disasters. Others quietly acknowledge that they remain in the country illegally. They don't give numbers.
They have to give us the names because we have, you know, many
illegal, more. Or they're not going to give you names.
They have to give us the names. And I have to say this. We believe so strongly. I hired a very big contractor, one of the most prestigious, one of the best in the world, to build the building. It's their responsibility to make sure they have
Doesn't
done.
Doesn't the buck stop with you, though?
Yes,
You're
it does.
You're paying their salaries.
Oh, absolutely. We have gone out of our way to make sure that everybody in that building is legal. And we do have some that became legal. Wait a minute. We have some, many, I think, that became, frankly, me, you, everybody. I mean, ultimately, we were all sort of in the group of immigrant, right? But we have done that to the absolute letter of the law. We're very, very careful
on it. But if the Washington Post can go there and talk to 15 people and find some illegal immigrants.
They haven't shown us anything. I wish they would give us some names. We would get them out immediately.
But you must have a guy on the job site.
We have more than one guy,
right.
And we check it probably more carefully than any job that was ever built. Anderson, you have either 11, anywhere from 11 to 34 million illegal immigrants in this country. They're all over the place. Nobody knows even where they come from. They probably come some from the Middle East. You don't know where they're coming from. We check on that building probably more carefully than anybody that's ever built a building before. And I think from what I heard, and I just checked it this morning because I asked a question because I read the article also, we are absolutely in beautiful, perfect shape. Now, I wish they'd give us the names. We would get rid of them immediately.
This isn't the first time, though, this has been an issue. Daily Beast today, there's an article. I don't know if you've seen it. The headline says, they're talking about the building we're sitting in right now. They're saying Trump Tower was built on undocumented immigrant backs.
How many years ago was that?
This was, 75
years ago.
35 years ago.
Yeah, they said 35 years ago.
But this was a court case. 200 illegal immigrants, Polish workers, guys working for $5.
Anderson, I hire a contractor. The contractor then hires a subcontractor. They have people. I don't know. I don't remember. That was so many years ago. 35 years ago, they said we had some
illegal. This was a court case settled in 1999. You settled with them.
It's all right. I mean, it's fine. I mean, I remember the case. Frankly, I remember it very well. We hire contractors. The contractor, very highly prestigious, very good. They go out, hire subcontractors. Sometimes the subcontractors will have people working, but, you know, it's pretty far down the line.
This was 200 Polish workers working without hard hats. Pretty noticeable on a union job.
When you have to go back 35 years to tell me about something, I think that's pretty pathetic, to be honest with you.
Do you think, can you guarantee that you don't have illegal or undocumented workers working for you in hotel projects or various projects?
I can't guarantee it. How can anyone? We have 34 million in the country. I used to hear 11. Now I hear it's 34 million. I can't guarantee anything. But I can say this. We work very hard to make sure that everybody is legal as opposed to illegal.
There's, as you said, 11, who knows how many millions, 11 million, one
nobody
figure,
knows.
Nobody knows.
Know.
Right,
and
nobody
by the way,
knows.
Most scary of all, our government doesn't know. They don't have an idea. They don't have a clue.
What would you do with the ones already here? You've talked about building a great wall on the border, or at least parts of the border, about being tough. What would you do with the ones that are already here?
I would do something very, very strong. Number one, I wouldn't even think about anything until I built a wall, impenetrable. There will be nobody coming into this country illegally. That's number one. Number two, I would get the ones that are criminals, drug dealers, and the people that are forced in by Mexico. And you know exactly what I'm talking about, because Mexico is smarter and sharper and more cunning and, frankly, have much better negotiators than we have. And I would get the ones that are forced in by the country of Mexico into our country, forced in. Those people would get out, and they'd get out fast. The rest I would be looking at very seriously. But I wouldn't.
Well, you say looking at citizenship seriously. Would there be a pathway to citizenship for, I mean, you're talking about 11 million at the very
it's
least.
Too early for me to say. And when you say citizenship, the most we'd be talking about was legal. But let me just tell you, before I even think about that, we have to build a wall, a real wall, not a wall that people walk through.
Okay, you talk about focusing on the criminals, deporting people. There are more people have been deported under Obama than any other president previously.
And more people are coming in under Obama by far than more president ever. There's never been an entrance like this. And they're walking right past our patrols.
But actually arrests on the border have gone up significantly.
I can just say this. More people are in this country right now illegally than ever before. I will build a better wall, and I'll build it for cheaper, and Mexico will pay, if that's your next question.
Yeah, how do you get Mexico to pay?
Because they are ripping us left and right.
But
Mexico.
How do you make
By
them
the
pay?
Way, I love the Mexican people. Many Mexican people work for me. Many Mexico people I do business with, they purchase things for me, like apartments, et cetera, et cetera. I have great relationships with Mexico and with the Mexican people. I love the Mexican people. I love their spirit.
But
let me just tell you. Mexico is making an absolute fortune because the trade deals with the United States are phenomenal for them and horrible for us. They're taking our jobs, they're building factories, warehouses, they're building things that we're not even thinking about.
So you say you renegotiate trade deals and in that put in a price for the wall?
Absolutely, and they will do it. And I've watched these very stupid pundits say, you can't do that. Of course you can do that. Mexico's making, I can do it. By the way, Hillary can't do it, Jeb can't do it. These people that are running, most of them can't do it. Maybe a couple of them. I actually have a respect for a couple of them. But Hillary cannot do it. I guarantee you that. Jeb Bush cannot do it. I can do it easy. Mexico is making a fortune off the United States. They will pay for that wall. Believe me.
We're going to have more of the interview. Quick fact check. Mr. Trump said there are more people now in this country illegally than ever before. That's not true. According to the Pew Research Center, the numbers dropped by about a million since its peak between 1990 and 2007. That wasn't all Donald Trump had to say about illegal immigration. Much more to come next.
If somebody's an illegal immigrant, they shouldn't be here at all. There shouldn't be any crime. They're not supposed to be in our country. They're supposed to be, and I'm not just talking Mexico.
Welcome back. Donald Trump's comments about illegal immigration have put the issue front and center in the presidential race. No doubt about it. His comments have cost him in business and frustrated many of his GOP opponents, but Trump is certainly not backing down. Take a look. You said when Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best. They're not sending you. They're sending people that have lots of problems. They're bringing those problems to us. They're bringing drugs. They're bringing crime. And they're rapists, you went on to say, and some of them are,
now,
probably okay.
How did you start it off? You said, when Mexico sends its people, when Mexico...
Well, let me ask you about
I'm
that.
I'm talking about the government.
What evidence do you have that the government sends their
people? Everybody knows it. This man, or this animal, that shot the wonderful, that beautiful woman in San Francisco, this guy was pushed out by Mexico. We bring him back and they push him out. Mexico pushes back people across the border that are criminals, that are drug dealers.
So... If the article that you're basing this on, this Fusion article that you've cited...
Well, that's just one of many articles.
Okay.
That talks about 80% rapes. But that's not it. Just look at Homeland Security reports. Look at all of the reports that have
come. But there are... I mean, you talked about their reports. I got to look at a bunch of studies here that say there's actually no correlation between illegal immigration and crime, and that, in fact, immigrants actually commit crimes at a lower number.
You're not a baby. Okay, you're not a baby.
I'm not saying there's
illegal
not a lot of individual
cases. Illegal
immigrants
coming in... are causing tremendous problems in terms of crime, in terms of murder, in terms of rape, in terms of lots of other
things. Let me give you two studies. Northwestern University, cited by the Washington Post, says essentially no correlation between illegal immigration and violent crime. Pew Research Center, using figures from the University of Massachusetts, found, quote, the crime rate among first-generation immigrants, those who came to this country from somewhere else, significantly lower than the overall crime rate and that of the second generation.
Anderson, if somebody's an illegal immigrant, they shouldn't be here at all. There shouldn't be any crime. They're not supposed to be in our country. They're supposed to be, and I'm not just talking Mexico. They're coming from all over the world. I'm not just talking about Mexico.
We're talking Central America as well, but you're saying that there is a correlation between...
And you're probably talking about the Middle East, and you're talking about other places. The southern border is a disaster. I'm speaking this weekend in Arizona. They say the crowd is going to be enormous. Somebody said I'm the most popular person in Arizona because I'm speaking the truth. Those people are living with it. When I look at Rick Perry, he talks about the border. He did a terrible job at the border. He was governor of Texas. He could have done a much better job than he did. He did a terrible job along the border.
So you don't believe these studies? You say that there is a correlation between crime and illegal
immigrants. Number one, but even if the studies were correct, I'm not talking about correlation. When you have illegal immigrants coming in, if they commit crime, they're not supposed to be here.
You did indicate that the people coming across the border were raping 80% of the women based on this fusion.
You are putting things.
All right,
read
so
the article. Did you pull up the article?
I did. I pulled up the article.
Now, that article was written by Fusion.
Right.
You know who owns Fusion?
Yeah, Univision.
Univision.
Right.
You know who I'm suing? Univision.
Right. But
and they have a big problem with my lawsuit. So let me just tell you something. Univision comes out like I'm some bad person. Univision's being being sued by me. The thing that they own is fusion, and they're talking about 80% rapes. I didn't make that up.
In that article, it says it's corrupt officials, it's traffickers, it's gangs,
sure,
and
it
other migrants
whatever
inside
it is.
Mexico.
But as I said before, it's called rape. It is rape, and it's happening, and it's a shame, and it's horrible.
So you stand by your comments?
I stand by whatever I read from Univision. Univision did it. I didn't do it.
Well, joining me now is CNN chief national correspondent John King, host of Inside Politics. And by the way, we'll have more of the interview coming up, and CNN chief political analyst Gloria Borger. So, John, first of all, on the illegal immigration, how big of a deal is it that Donald Trump says he can't guarantee that illegal immigrants don't work for any of his businesses or any of his construction sites, that nobody can guarantee that? How much does that open him up to allegations of hypocrisy? And I should also point out, he says they do more on that site to try to, you know, eliminate any illegal immigrants.
Well, it does open him up to challenges of hypocrisy. It'll be interesting to see whether anybody in the Republican field goes after him or whether that comes from outside. It also, you get to the question where, you know, he's the guy who says, I'm running because I'm a businessman. I make smart decisions. I don't, you know, anybody does stupid things, I fire. He thinks everybody who's worked in the government apparently in the last 25 years is stupid, to use his word. And yet he says, when you asked him and challenged him, he says, well, I hire a contractor who then hires a subcontractor. And, you know, I guess these things happen. Well, you can't have it both ways. You're either the boss who's the businessman who doesn't hire stupid people, or you're the boss of the businessman who apparently hired somebody who did things that are against the law. So it's interesting as this plays out, Anderson. That's a fascinating conversation. You know, when you challenge him on the facts, he blames somebody else or he comes up with some conspiracy theory. Whether that has legs over the long term is the big question. Most people who've watched politics for a long time think it won't last.
It was interesting, Gloria, because he said, you know, I pointed out the Daily Beast article that was released today about this court case he was involved with, the 200 illegal immigrants from Poland were used to clear the land that the Trump Tower is built on back 35 years ago. He says it's pathetic to bring it up. It's so far ago. But, I mean, during a debate, that's the kind of thing. He's now running for president. He's in a different category. You know, they went after Mitt Romney for
landscapers.
Yeah, landscapers.
Right. I mean, they went after Mitt Romney because somebody who was in charge of the landscaping on his property hired somebody who was an illegal immigrant to take care of the yard. And so when you're running for president, it's kind of a different ball game. And Donald Trump should understand that, and I think he's beginning to understand it, because when you seek the highest office in the land, everything, your records are going to be poured through, whether it was 35 years ago, whether it was 3 years ago. And I think he's doing that to his fellow Republicans, talking about their previous record, calling Hillary Clinton the worst Secretary of State, you know, in history, and then saying he donated to her campaign. You know, these are questions that he has to answer. And by the way, Anderson, I think he has to have a better answer on the Hillary Clinton question and why he donated to her campaign than it was just part of the game. I was just playing the game. I think people don't like that game very much.
Well, although, John, to his point, he's both critical of the game, but also says, essentially, I was playing the game. He at least kind of points out the discrepancy there. I mean, that's a conflict.
Well, he points out one of the things that everybody hates about politics, right? Because the average Joe out there thinks that big business or big rich people or big donors get together and they get the meetings with the senator. They get the meetings with the White House staff. They get access to the president, and the average Joe doesn't. So he's saying that's just the game, but then he's conceding he plays it. And so, again, you can raise the question of, you know, how are you a hypocrite or are you now a reformed sinner? That's one he's going to have to answer. But, again, you know, it's when you challenge him on facts, he pushes back and he says, you're no baby, Anderson. Yes, you're no baby, Anderson, and you did your research for the interview, and you come to him with the facts. It is a fact that the number of border crossings is down. Now, most people say that's not because of any breakthrough in border security. It's mostly because the Mexican economy is doing better, so people are staying. I spoke to several attorneys general this week, including the attorney general of this state where I am tonight, California, who say that, to your point, that the percentage of, and number one, she criticized the heinous crime in San Francisco. She said it was horrible. But by percentage, she says especially violent crime committed by the undocumented is way down. It's a tiny statistic. This is a horrible case, but statistically, it is very low. But when you press him on that, he just challenges you or questions your credibility as opposed to addressing what are known as facts.
Although, Gloria, I will say talking to Donald Trump is different than talking to any other politician out there, because he does, I mean, again, he showed up basically on his own. He's not there with sort of an advisor telling him you got to wrap it up. you got to have these talking points. He does seem very much his own person. Whether you agree with him or not, he's not giving. I mean, you compare it to the interview that Hillary Clinton gave yesterday, that other politicians might give. They don't want to, you know, necessarily come out on with any real position. He very much, whether you like the positions or not, he at least seems to take them.
He engages, and that's, and you know, he's not talking from a set of talking points that somebody else has written for him. It's clear he reads what he reads, and he comes up with his own talking points. And by the way, Anderson, he speaks to a certain segment of the base of the Republican Party, to which his sort of brash demeanor and his "I'm telling it like it is" appeals to them.
Yeah.
And you know, Republicans have to pay attention to that, because he does have an appeal in the Republican Party in the primaries in which they're running.
Yeah, no doubt about that. You look at the polls. Gloria, thank you. John King, stay with us. A lot more to talk about. More of my interview with Donald Trump just ahead. Up next, he doesn't seem to care about the backlash on his immigration comments, but does he care about the price tag? How much has this cost you?
I mean, a lot. Oh, it cost me a lot.
Can you put a dollar figure on the loss of...
It's a lot of money, but fortunately, I'm very rich. It doesn't matter to me. Does it matter? No. What matters to me is making America great again.
More of my conversation now with Donald Trump. As you know, his comments about illegal Mexican immigrants have cost him a lot. There have been repercussions from NBC, Univision, the beauty pageants he owns, Macy's, NASCAR, and the list goes on. In fact, I should point out, wasn't just talking about Mexican immigrants, illegal immigrants, also from Central America. He said several times today and countless times in the past, he's very rich and he doesn't seem to care or even know what the backlash actually adds up to from a dollars and cents standpoint. Take a look. How much has this cost you?
I mean, a lot. Oh, it cost me a lot.
Can you put a dollar figure on the loss of...
It's a lot of money, but fortunately, I'm very rich. It doesn't matter to me. Does it matter? No. What matters to me is making America great again.
You don't have a dollar figure. This has cost you X amount.
It's you know, it's sort of funny. One of them was big headline: Trump loses NASCAR. You know what they were doing? They were renting a ballroom from me for one night.
And they already have a deposit
there. It was a banquet hall. And they left a deposit. And now I have it rented already to somebody else.
So is it just small potatoes, or is it...
There was another one. Fortunately, it's not big for me. There's another one. ESPN breaks up with Trump. All over the world, separate stories, headlines. ESPN. They rented my golf course in Los Angeles for a day. 120 or 200 golfers or something. They rent. So I kept their deposit, which is very nice of them. And now I have other people using it, so I get two for the price of one. No, but the point is, the press is so dishonest. People hear NASCAR, ESPN break. Now, here's the good news. I'm very rich. I've built an unbelievable company. The money you're talking about is a lot, but it's peanuts for me. But it's still a lot. More expensive than a campaign would cost.
Someone in your organization told me that the lawsuit against Univision, if you win that, you could actually fund your entire campaign with the Univision fund deal.
Well, they owe me a lot of money. Look. They have a contract. It's a binding contract. No, you know, I'm very good at contracts. I do that very well, okay? Unlike our country, I do contracts very well, or I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you right now. So we have a binding contract, and Univision says, we're going to terminate the contract. You know, to this day, they haven't sent me. I have a five-year binding contract signed in January, not long ago, five, 6 months ago, signed. They made their first payment. No termination right, zero. They went to the press. They said they're going to terminate. Now, the problem is they terminated before their IPO. How stupid is that? I mean, the head of Univision, frankly, should be fired. But they terminate before? They know I have a major claim. So I sue them, and now they have a lot of problems.
Let me ask you, as I said, you've been very vocal in the media, very accessible. You're on Twitter. There was a tweet that caused you problems that was rescinded. It was a retweet about Jeb Bush's wife. You said the original tweet said Jeb Bush has to like the Mexican illegals because of his wife. That was somebody else said that. You retweeted it. Did you authorize that? Did you regret that?
No, I didn't authorize it. I don't regret anything. Look, it was a retweet. It wasn't me. And it was actually... If you look at it carefully, it was a retweet of a Breitbart story that was a very good story, a very fair story, a very strong story, a very good story. But do I regret? No, I don't regret it. I mean, you know, look, I would say that he would. If my wife were from Mexico, I think I would have a soft spot for people from Mexico. I can understand.
Do you think that influences his position on illegal immigration?
I think it could. I mean, maybe it should. If he loves his wife, and I know he does, I hear she's a lovely woman, by the way. So if he loves his wife, and she's from Mexico, I think it probably has an influence in him, yes. I can understand that.
Well, coming up more in my interview with Donald Trump, will you hear his strategy for defeating ISIS in Iraq? Would you send U.S. troops? Wars.
I would do things that would be so tough that I don't even know if they'd be around to come to the table.
What sort of things, though?
I mean, I would take away their wealth. I would take away the oil. What you should be doing now is taking away the oil.
My conversation today with Donald Trump covered a lot of ground, foreign policy included. True to form, he was never at a loss for words, no matter what I asked. We'll let you be the judge of his actual answers. Now, among the many statements he's made since announcing his candidacy, he said that nobody would be tougher on ISIS than he would. But he hasn't given a lot of details about that, so I tried to pin him down on specifics to explain in detail what his strategy against ISIS would be. Take a look. I want to ask you about ISIS. You said nobody would be tougher on ISIS than Donald Trump.
Nobody.
Specifically, what would be your strategy?
The situation with ISIS has to be dealt firmly and strongly. When you have people being beheaded, I would love not to be over there. That's not our fight. That's other people's fights. That's revolutions. That's whatever you want to call it.
It's
religious wars. I would do things that would be so tough that I don't even know if they'd be around to come to the table.
What sort of things, though?
I mean, I would take away their wealth. I would take away the oil. What you should be doing now is taking away the oil.
What does that mean?
Bomb the hell. And I'll tell you what I hate about this question. If I win, I didn't want to answer this question, and I thought maybe I could go without answering. Because if you look at the great General George Patton or General MacArthur, who I was a big fan of, or any of these great generals, they didn't talk about what they did. And I said, I hate it. In fact, if you remember when I said, I have a plan, but I don't want to talk about it. The problem is everyone said, oh, he really doesn't have a plan. Okay, so I had to do it. But I hate talking about it, because if I win, they know I'm going to do it. If I win, I would attack those oil sites that are controlled and owned by ISIS. They're controlled by ISIS. They're taking tremendous money out. They are renovating a hotel in Iraq. Can you believe it?
But wouldn't you be destroying the wealth of Iraq?
No, let me. There is no Iraq. Their leaders
Iraqis
are corrupt.
Might differ with
Excuse
you.
Me. There are no Iraqis. They're broken up into so many different factions in
but
Iraq.
You don't think bombing Iraqi oil fields, which are now in the control of ISIS,
but
bombing Iraqi oil fields is going to anger huge numbers of people?
I would bomb
Iraq?
The hell out of those oil fields. I wouldn't send many troops because you won't need them by the time I got finished. I'd bomb the hell out of the oil fields. I'd then get Exxon. I'd then get these great oil companies to go in. They would rebuild them so fast your head will spin.
Do you ever see U.S. troops?
You ever see how fast they put up rigs? These guys are unbelievable. So I'd go ExxonMobil. I'd go to the top five oil companies. They'd be in there. They'd be finished so fast.
Don't you need U.S. troops to protect the oil companies?
You put a ring around them. You put a ring. You have just taken all of the wealth away. This is what should be done. But no politician's going to do that.
Joining me now, CNN political commentator, Republican strategist Anna Navarro, a Jeb Bush supporter and advisor to other GOP candidates, Bill Kristol, editor of the Weekly Standard, and CNN political commentator and Democratic strategist Paul Begala, who's co-chair of a pro-Hillary Clinton super PAC and longtime advisor to President Clinton in the 1990s. Anna, Donald Trump saying in one breath that Jeb Bush is weak on immigration, then says, well, Bush's wife is from Mexico and that maybe influences him or probably influences him. I mean, is that personal territory? Is that political?
I have no idea. It's Donald Trump speak, which really is such incoherent discourse that I have a very hard time analyzing it and responding it. I really give you a hell of a lot of credit for maintaining a straight face and trying to conduct this interview as if you were doing it with a normal person, because I think anybody watching can see that he just goes beyond logical discourse.
Bill Kristol, I mean, I know you've said it's a good thing that Trump's voice is part of this Republican cycle. You're not necessarily a fan of his. His opponents treat him with disdain at their own peril. When you hear him tonight saying things like there is no Iraq, there are no Iraqis, bomb the hell out of the oil fields, is that a serious contender?
He probably won't be the nominee because he is irresponsible in things that he says and sometimes says distasteful things. On the other hand, there's something impressive about some of what he says. There's a certain kind of common sense that we should be tough and strong. And he's ridiculed by the mainstream media. I give you a lot of credit for pretending to be disapproving of him when obviously you've enjoyed the interview and obviously you found him 10 times more interesting than every single politician you've ever interviewed.
I've said that publicly.
You enjoy talking to him. You have done a great job, but I mean, Gloria and John King are being serious and, he should learn some things about politics. You can't get away with this. He knows what he's doing. And look, at the end of the day, the Republican Party is a big tent. There's plenty of room for Donald Trump. There's plenty of room for the establishment politicians who will disapprove of what Donald Trump says and will distinguish themselves from Donald Trump. It's good for the party to have him in. I much prefer the Republican field with Donald Trump than watching Hillary Clinton's interview with Brianna last night. Boring, platitudes, typical politician. Let the Republicans have some interesting people.
Paul, let me ask you about that, because Hillary Clinton wouldn't even say which, you know, actress on Saturday Night Live she liked doing an imitation of her better, or who should be on, you know, what bill, or even what bill it should be. Is there something good for the Republican Party that you have Donald Trump, you know, at least taking positions, whether, you know, you think they're ludicrous or not?
I think it's great. Now, I don't know what's good for the Republican Party. I think it's great. It's great for the
Democratic
Party.
You think it's great
for the Democrats? Donald Trump is God's gift to the Democratic Party, cable TV pundits, and late-night comics. We're all having a Trumpgasm. I hate that I'm taking time out of your interview with him. More Donald Trump. He is the face of the Republican Party, the voice of the Republican Party. He's the hair of the Republican Party. If you look, a lot of their voters look like him. It's the best thing ever happened, because
this is Paul's desperate attempt to whistle past the graveyard. They have a horrible candidate they're coronating, and he's trying to pretend that Donald Trump is a problem for the Republicans. Is Donald Trump going to be the Republican nominee? No. Is it going to matter? Is it going to matter in October? No.
I want
more
Trump.
Paul, let's just go back to the fact that out of all the candidates running, the only one who was sitting at the front pew of his third wedding was your candidate, Hillary Clinton, the one that he gave $100,000 to her Clinton Family Foundation was Hillary Clinton. The one that got political donations, maxed out political donations from Donald Trump, was Hillary Clinton. I've come to believe he's a Democrat mole. I think he's a Hillary Clinton mole, do some harm to the Republican Party.
The candidates you support are all having to react to Donald Trump. I mean, whether you think he's ridiculous or not, he has, in many ways, defined the debate.
You're right, Anderson, and I am glad that they've stood up and they've condemned what he said. I am glad that Jeb Bush has said that he found it personally offensive. I frankly am very disappointed that the only words Hillary Clinton could come up with to talk about what Donald Trump said was very disappointed. Listen, very disappointed is what you are when your new puppy pees on your carpet. What Donald Trump said was offensive, it was disgusting, it was racist, it was wrong, it was misinformed, and certainly you would think that the Democrat presumptive nominee could come up with stronger words than very disappointed to describe it.
Bill, just be clear, if Donald Trump is on that debate stage, and there's no reason to believe he's number two in the polls, he certainly has earned a place there. I mean, Paul says it's good for the Democratic Party. You say it's good for the Republican Party. Why do you think it's good for the Republican Party? Is it because it allows the other candidates to kind of define themselves in his reflection and sort of show themselves as different as him, or because it shows the breadth and a vigorous debate?
Yeah, I think it's a big tent. The people who like Donald Trump will be happy with what he says. The people who don't like Donald Trump will be happy when some of the other candidates distance themselves from Trump. It'll make the debate lively. One reason I do like it, because I'm not pro-Trump. I'm slightly anti-Trump because I'm so sick of all the establishment types being so earnest and disdaining him. And this serves the Republican Party right. They've set up this debate, 10 people, excluding the so-called minor candidates, some of whom are very impressive and not so minor candidates, like Carly Fiorina and Rick Perry and others who might get excluded. So they set this up. They tried to control everything. They set up a situation where who's going to dominate that debate? I suspect Donald Trump. And you know what? I sort of think it serves the others right. And it puts more pressure on Jeb Bush and Scott Walker and Marco Rubio, people I like and respect, to have something to say. Well, because if they get up there and are platitudinous politicians, they're going to look pale compared to Donald Trump.
I think that's an interesting point. Paul, Donald Trump has given a ton of interviews. Hillary Clinton's only given her first national one yesterday. Do you think, is he upstaging her? I mean, why isn't she coming forward and talking? It does seem surprising, no?
She's talking a lot, just not to national media, except
CNN. Well, she's running for president. She's talking to small groups of people.
Right, because she's already famous. And she's not, Hillary, I'm sure she's got an ego. I know her well, but she doesn't have an ego like Donald. This is exactly what should be happening.
Nobody does, Paul.
She's going town to town, person to person. She's giving interviews to Iowa journalists and to New Hampshire journalists. She did give one to CNN. I think that's fine. But what Trump is doing is really important. He is not dumb. He's a very smart guy. And he is channeling the id of the Republican base voter. And Bill is right. He's going to get up on that stage. The Republicans are going to watch this. They're not going to want that fancy Jeb Bush Pellegrino water or the Marco Rubio Perrier. They want that Donald Trump crazy water.
Well, okay, Democrats would like the Bernie. Democrats want the Bernie Sanders water.
Right. So the billionaire,
Hillary Clinton doesn't seem to be debating Bernie. When is that Democratic debate happening, Paul? When do we get to see? Anderson, wouldn't you like to have Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton up on the stage together?
Yeah, I would like to have anybody up on that stage.
I want a Donald Trump channel, a Donald Trump show, a Donald Trump network. Just make sure to put Republican under his name. He's the voice of the Republican Party.
Anna Navarro, thank you. Thank you all. Appreciate it. More of my interview with Trump ahead. I asked him about what he'd do if he doesn't get the Republican nomination. You rule out the idea of running as an independent party candidate or third party candidate if for some reason you don't get the GOP nomination.
Everybody asks me to do it. I have had so many people saying, would you run as an independent? Would you run as a third party candidate? And I think, you know, they see the kind of votes I get, a lot of votes.
Donald Trump certainly is not the first presidential candidate with a healthy ego. What sets him apart is that he doesn't try to feign modesty. The art of the humble brag, not exactly his wheelhouse. By his own estimation, he's great at many things, including foreign policy. He told me that if he's elected, Vladimir Putin will be jumping at his commands and turning over Edward Snowden, who he considers a traitor. Former Attorney General Holder just the other day said perhaps some sort of plea deal could be in the works. He also said that Snowden spurred a necessary debate. Yeah. What would you do about Snowden?
I think he's a total traitor, and I would deal with him harshly. And if I were president, Putin would give him over. I would get along with Putin. I've dealt with Russia.
You think he'd get along with Putin?
I think I'd get along with him fine. I think he'd be absolutely fine. He would never keep somebody like Snowden in Russia. He hates Obama. He doesn't respect Obama. Obama doesn't like him either. But he has no respect for Obama, has a hatred for Obama, and Snowden is living the life. Look, if I'm president, Putin says, hey, boom, you're gone. I guarantee you that.
I think I know the answer to this question. Would you accept a vice presidential position if it didn't work out for you for president? Look, I mean, you're doing great right now, but
I'm doing, but it's not that I wouldn't. It's a phenomenal position. I think it's a very powerful position. It's not for me. I love what I'm doing. I'd rather be doing this.
So
I have buildings
all
over the world. I'm not doing this to be president. I'm doing this to make America great again.
You rule out the idea of running as an independent party candidate or third party candidate if for some reason you don't get the GOP nomination.
Everybody asks me to do it. I have had so many people saying, would you run as an independent? Would you run as a third party candidate? And I think, you know, they see the kind of votes. I get a lot of votes. The best way of defeating the Democrats, and probably Hillary, I think it's going to be Hillary, is to run as a Republican. If I do the third party thing, it would be, I think, very bad for the Republicans. I think it would be very bad in terms of beating the Democrats, and we have to win.
George H.W. Bush still points to Ross Perot as being the reason he didn't get reelected. You don't want to be the Ross Perot.
Let me tell you, Ross Perot, I know that whole thing very good, 19% of the vote. Ross Perot, had he not been there, you would have never heard of Bill Clinton. You would have never heard. In my opinion, Bush would have gotten almost 100% of those votes. Now, I actually spoke to Bill Clinton once. He said, no, we're split 50-50. No, and that's a smart thing for him to say. No way. Had Ross Perot not run, you would never have heard of Bill Clinton.
Mr. Trump, thank you.
Thank you.
With me again, CNN Chief National Correspondent John King, host of Inside Politics, and CNN Chief Political Analyst Gloria Borger. So, John, I mean, it's interesting. He didn't close the door, I guess, on a third-party run. Still a long way out, but even just the idea of it must concern Republicans.
Yes, it concerns Republicans, but he understands the Perot experience. It's very hard for a third party candidate to win. However, there is the reason Trump is doing well in the Republican primary so far, second place in the polls, getting so much attention, is there is such a disgust with politics in America in both parties. So there is this opportunity for an independent candidacy. It costs a lot of money. He has that money. Is he the right guy? Is he Ross Perot? I'm not so sure. But Anderson, if I could quickly turn to one thing he just said. Look, there's a lot of what he says. There's a lot of what he says that just makes you shake your head. He thinks, you know, he's elected and China will revalue its currency because Donald Trump says so. Mexico will pay for the wall because Donald Trump says so. But what he just said there is that Putin would not turn over Snowden, but I would get along with Putin. Well, I don't know if Republican voters are going to like that. Vladimir Putin in the last 5 years has seized territory in two sovereign nations, Georgia and Ukraine. That's a guy you want to get along with?
Can I just also point out one thing he just said to you, Anderson, which was that he would invade Iraq. Period. Right. I mean,
well, he said he would bomb the hell out of the oil fields and then send in Exxon and a couple oil companies and then send in troops to form a ring around them.
Exactly. Well, that sort of sounds like invading Iraq to me. And I think that if I were a Republican candidate, I think a lot of them have been shy because they didn't want to light a match under Donald Trump. I think we're kind of past that point right now. So if I were Jeb Bush, whose voters, by the way, are probably not Trump voters, why not use Donald Trump as a foil right now and say, wait a minute, you want to attack Iraq?
Wait a minute, but Trump is very strong on Jeb Bush, saying, look, Jeb Bush, you know, spent days trying to come up with an answer for
whether he's right about that.
And Trump says all along that he was always against an invasion of Iraq.
Well, but now he's saying invade Iraq. And what Jeb said was, that it was a mistake eventually.
I don't understand, just on his Iraq thing, I mean, is if you bomb the oil fields of Iraq, you are going to, turn everybody in Iraq against you. He says there is no Iraq, there are no Iraqis.
Yeah, I mean, it was sort of hard to
square. Or you're going to kill.
Go ahead,
John. Or you're going to kill thousands of civilians. If you just bomb the oil fields, you're still going, there's going to be some collateral damage. And then to the point that there are, as he says, yes, there's a lot of factional, sectarian violence, grief, and separation in Iraq, and the political system is dysfunctional. But he also says Exxon will rush in to rebuild the oil fields and will just put a ring around them. Well, that ring would be U.S. troops. That would be,
right,
if not nation building, business building, again, in a sovereign nation.
Right.
It's just, if Frank Underwood said these things, we would think they were kind of funny. this guy's running for president.
John King, Gloria Borger, appreciate you being on. We'll be right back. I talked to Donald Trump today for about 40 or so minutes. We're going to have more of my interview with Trump on tomorrow night's broadcast of 360 at 8 o'clock Eastern. I hope you join us for that. In that, we went down the list of other candidates, GOP candidates, also Bernie Sanders, and obviously more on Hillary Clinton, to get his thoughts on all of them. You'll want to hear that ahead. That'll be tomorrow night, 8 p.m. I hope you join us. That does it for us in this hour. The CNN special report, No Laughing Matter, Inside the Cosby Allegations, starts now.